Session on salience of geography, and we have three eminent panelists here, starting with a person of immense literary skills and interest, that is Dr. Sanjeev Chopra. Then we have a very noted military historian and producer of documentaries, that is Kunal Verma, and a Firebrand award-winning journalist from my home state, Jammu and Kashmir, a union territory, Aarti Tikku. So, you see, the two books written by Robert Kaplan, one is The Revenge of Geography and second is Monsoons, aptly cover the significance of geography in the geopolitics and strategic security. And in fact, when he describes geography, he says that it's not only the physical attributes of the land, it also includes resources, people, politics, connectivity, trade and conflicts, all impacted by modern technology. About the Second World War, there were about 100 countries or nation states. But after the decolonization and tectonic geopolitical shifts, about 100 more states were added, and today we have about 200 odd countries in the world. Generally, we have been defining geography or examining geography from three theoretical precepts. One is Mackinder's heartland theory, where he gives a lot of prominence to Eurasia. Then you have Spikeman's rimland theory. These are those states who have stakes in the maritime domain as well as in the continental domain. And then, of course, those are outlier islands like United States of America who propound Mahan theory. Be that as it is, geography as a key determinant of geopolitics is presently marked by two contrasting trends. On one hand, technology has accelerated free movement of people and goods, thus giving impetus to globalization and the very notion of mapless world, global citizens, and global village. But on the flip side, in a COVID-impacted world, what we see is nation states exhibiting a fortress mentality steeped in heightened cartographic consciousness and assertion. And a case in point is China. But whatever we may say, maps remain central symbols of state sovereignty, and many of the intra and interstate disputes today devolve around contested borders. And this is more true in the Indian subcontinent. Traditionally, what has happened that these areas, be it Eurasia, Indo-Pacific, have witnessed contestation of balance of power. And today, this has accentuated, be it in the Eurasian heartland or in the Indo-Pacific, and new political, geopolitical alignments are taking shape there. So, from that perspective, if you look at India, where is India positioned geographically? India is quintessentially a rimland state and has pivotal stakes both in the heartland and in the maritime space of the Indo-Pacific. Gauging from the historical perspective, the salience of geography in the geopolitics of Indian subcontinent has been profound, be it cross-fertilization of civilizations along the old Silk Route, be it series of invasions that came from the north, or be it seafaring facilitated by the monsoon winds in the Indian Ocean region. India's subjugation by the British and its wake, the great game that ensued in Greater Central Asia, leading to the strategic salience of Afghanistan as a buffer and a bridge, has still its implications in today's geopolitics. And the very partition of India and emergence of new state boundaries marked by Redcliffe line, McMahon line, presently you have the LOC, LAC, the AGPL in Siachen Glacier, and the like have become the perennial sources of India-Pakistan-China contestation. Revenge of geography dismantled the much-touted two-nation theory, and it became a critical factor in the creation of Bangladesh. Today, China is once again determined to alter the geographical landscape of our region by pushing through the Belt and Road Initiative, the Maritime Silk Route, and in it, India's own neighborhood, we have China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, China-Nepal Economic Corridor, China-Myanmar Economic Corridor, and the so-called String of Pearls in the very Indian Ocean region. Looking it from the military security angle, there is a view that China's disruptive technology-enabled military modernization has diluted the efficacy of geographical barrier and distances. China is emerging a leader in multi-domain warfare and gray zone conflicts, of which are the wars of the future, thus gaining yet another competitive advantage over India. Pakistan, in any case, has used terrorism information operations as effective asymmetric tools under a nuclear overhang. Pak-China multi-domain warfare strategic nexus has added a new dimension to India's strategic security calculus. No matter from which vantage point you see, geography, tempered with technology, has played and will continue to play a profound role in the future regional geopolitical and strategic security milieu of India. So with these introductory words, I would first request Dr. Sanjeev Chopra, who is working on a very important project on maps of India, just to give us a sense on the genesis of the maps and ever-changing maps of the Indian subcontinent, a little bit about this, how, what impact it has. So about 5 minutes.
Yeah, thank you so much, General. General Sharma has made my task both difficult and easy. Let's talk about the difficulty. The difficulty is that he's talked about all the lines, the Radcliffe line and the McMahon line and the Durand line, the lines which, you know, the interesting thing about the civilizational geography of India and the geography of the nation state of India, you know, we've got to understand that these are two different constructs. One is the civilizational geography of India, which is very clearly marked by the Hindu Kush Mountains, by the Arabian Sea, the Bay of Bengal, and the side of the northeastern frontier areas, you know, the areas around Burma. Now, this is one of the geographical constructs of India, the Jambudweep, the construction of Jambudweep as we were knowing it. But the three lines which define the subcontinent are lines which defy geography. For example, the Radcliffe line is totally, does not take geography into account at all. In fact, it disrupts geography. It was cast, the Radcliffe line was cast, and it just cut asunder trade ties, cultural ties, political ties, and it has had such a great impact on India, and it continues to have an impact on India. It's got nothing to do with geography. It is a very, very artificial line. Same again, as far as the McMahon line is concerned, there is an aspect of geography to it, but more than geography, it is the politics of that line which is even more important. And as far as the Durand line is concerned, it's been a line of misery because even Durand did not. And interestingly, these are three lines which have shaped India, with the creators of these lines being totally unaware of the implications of these lines on the history, on the histories of the three countries that have emerged from there. Now, you know, there is this, as he's already mentioned about Kaplan's book. I mean, the other book was, of course, the one which was written that the world is flat, in which it was said that geography has lesser and lesser impact as technology takes form. But I would, in the construct of the map of the Indian subcontinent, which from 1947 to 2019 has been changed about 108 times, and such that not a single state or union territory of the country is the same as it was at the time of independence. Punjab, for example, which stretched from Gurgaon right up to Peshawar and Rawalpindi, actually has seen 10 formations within itself. 10 formations have happened within Punjab, likewise within Bengal, within all parts of the country. Because as far as the British India was concerned, with 562 states and all, geography was, I mean, the colonial state did not recognize geography. One of the aspects, one of the impacts of the British rule all over the world has been that it did not recognize the natural geographies. It was a colonial geography which was imposed on us. Thus, at that point of time, the state of Hyderabad, for example, was a multilingual, multi-unitary state. I mean, no, there was no inherent core to it. For that matter, even the state of Jammu wa, Kashmir wa, Ladakh wa, Tibet wa. I mean, there is no organic unity between Tibet and Ladakh, and I mean, no geographic. They're of course geographically continuous, but just because a place is geographically continuous does not mean that it gets a geographic essence or it gets a geographic construct about it. So my view on the subject is that nation states and even groups of nation states ought to recognize the salient role which geography has, because we can reconstruct our politics. We can reconstruct our politics around geography, but geography cannot be asked to construct itself along man-made lines. So human beings, we have a role, and an important role and a significant role, in trying to define our interests, our nationalities, our linguistic trends within geographies. But geography is not going to listen to man-made lines. These are the opening comments which I like to make, because I'm now working on how, over the last 75 years, India has been able to adjust, I mean, the nation state of India, because remember that the constitution says, the preamble says that we the people of India, and then the constitution says that Bharat, that is India, the union of states. So you have a very interesting complex. So we are creating this nation time and again, and the new nation that is constructing itself is taking account of geography, is taking account of language, it's taking account of ethnicities. As long as human beings learn to recognize, understand, acknowledge geography, it'll be better in the long run. It'll create lesser tensions, because tensions will always be there. I mean, we cannot live and expect a tension-free world. That will never happen. But the issue for humankind would be to see how best we can manage, how best we can adjust, how best we can take care of aspirations to ensure that they do not contradict geography in the way things are happening. But some of the greatest events that have happened in the last few years, in the last few decades, have been things which are not really made by geography. The Berlin Wall was not geography. I mean, so many things that have been created are not based on geography. So geography plays a role. Geography ought to play a very different kind of role. That's my take on the subject today.
Thank you, Dr. Chopra. I think this has given us a lot of food for thought. See, at the time of partition, creation of Pakistan created a disruption in the natural geography of the region. And it became a boon for Pakistan in a way that, well, it had access to Xinjiang and Central Asia, and our own connectivity with our civilizational neighbor got disrupted. At the same time, it had another problem, because it did not share borders with any of the other South Asian states. And one of its important part, or the bigger part, was separated by about 1600 kilometers. Which was untenable if you look at from the geopolitical realism, that it was not sustainable, even the cultural differences. So geography has and would continue to play an important role in India-Pakistan relations and in the overall South Asia. But coming to the impact of geography on 1971 war, what has been that impact and what are major takeaways from there? Over to you, Kunal.
So, thank you. So the geographical divisions in India, of course, as Dr. Sanjeev Chopra, he said General Sharma had made his job difficult. By the time he finished, I didn't know what to say. Actually, you know, on a lighter note, let's first start with this. I was shooting the NDA film. There was Colonel Gidd, who was from Maharashtra. He was a Maharashtra. And he was got commissioned into the Punjab regiment, and the way the troops bully him around for a while, then he sort of made a name for himself, and then he told them, he was trying to explain to them, look, I'm also a Maratha, I come from the Shivaji land and all that. So they listened to him very quietly, and then they said, Dekho ji, ਉੱਥੇ ਸਤਲਜ ਹੈਗੀ ਸਤਲਜ ਦੇ ਉਸ ਪਾਰ ਸਾਰੇ ਹੀ ਤੰਬੀ ਹੈਗੇ ਐਂਡ ਆਈ ਹੈਵ ਸਟੱਡੀਡ ਇਨ ਦ ਸਾਊਥ ਐਵਰੀਬਡੀ ਲੁਕਸ ਅਪਵਰਡ ਸਾਰੇ ਸਰਦਾਰ ਹੈ ਵਾਪੇ ਬੈਠੇ ਹੋਏ ਐਵਰੀਬਡੀ ਲੁਕਸ ਲਾਈਕ ਇਨ ਦ ਸੇਮ ਥਿੰਗ ਫੋਰ ਦ ਨੌਰਥ ਈਸਟ ਐਟਸੈਟਰਾ ਐਟਸੈਟਰਾ ਰੀਡਿਫਾਈਨਿੰਗ ਆਫ ਬਾਰਡਰਸ ਐਟਸੈਟਰਾ ਵੈਰੀ ਵੈਰੀ ਕ੍ਰਿਟੀਕਲ ਸਰ ਆਈ ਥਿੰਕ ਵਨ ਆਫ ਦ ਬਿਗੈਸਟ ਫੇਲੀਅਰਸ ਵੀ ਹੈਡ ਇਨ 1965 ਲੀਡਿੰਗ ਅਪ ਟੂ 1971 ਵਾਸ ਦ ਕੰਪਲੀਟ ਲੈਕ ਆਫ ਅੰਡਰਸਟੈਂਡਿੰਗ ਆਫ ਦ ਜੋਗ੍ਰਾਫੀ ਆਫ ਵੈਸਟ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨ ਵੈਨ ਵੀ ਐਕਚੁਲੀ ਲਾਂਚ ਦ ਅਟੈਕਸ ਇਨ ਟੂ ਇਨ ਟੂ ਦ ਪੰਜਾਬ ਐਂਡ ਇਨ ਟੂ ਈਵਨ ਰਾਜਸਥਾਨ ਸਰ We even failed to understand how the basically the Rachna Doab, which is the Ravi and the Bias, the which is what we call the Lahore sector. The Bari Doab, which is this sector, and then you have the Rachna Doab, which is basically the Sialkot sector. These are all interwoven and they're kind of broken into little blocks. If you look at the canal system that exists, which the British built, and then the Pakistanis took it further. They even built the Echugal Canal, which we've partly funded, as a defensive obstacle. But in 1965, none of the infantry units, none of the armored units, nobody had a clue about what they were up against. And how far inside was it? 6 kilometers, 7 kilometers, 8 kilometers. Because there was a mindset. Now, Alfred Cook, whose action in the Kalaikunda I start with, he was a young flight lieutenant, and I think it was Tipnis who was that time commanding a squadron. And he said, "Sir, let me catch the Indian Airlines flight and go to Dhaka and see what is the layout of Tezgaon and the other airfield over there, Kumitola." I think that time they were landing at Kumitola, sir. And Tipnis said, "No, but that would be spying. We can't do that. It's against the spirit of warfare, etc." So you actually charged into this whole thing. And you really had very little idea about the geographical features and even how to divide it, etc. And to a great extent, 1965, in my opinion, we failed to really optimize what we wanted to do because we did not really understand the geography of Pakistan, despite the fact that Pakistan at that time was a new country. A lot of people had come from that side. And when we come to 1971, just how important it is to know the layout of the terrain, etc., I can only give you the example of the Navy, sir. Admiral Nanda, sir, his father had been the harbour master in Karachi. And he could actually zero in and when the missile boats went in, they never used missiles before, etc. Yet they managed to set the refineries ablaze because the man knew the layout. I mean, this is a macro version of geography. In 1965, we failed to destroy the war-making ability of Pakistan for various reasons, for which I think we should hang our heads in shame, frankly speaking, because, there are reasons for it. The entire situation when we come into 1971, to some extent, was also the same. There was the Meghna. Initially, General Manekshaw was not looking beyond the Meghna. It is a series of events which have actually started with the Battle of Ashugan, where General Sadat, who was a very dynamic commander, was in a helicopter, he was sitting on top, he saw the whole situation changing on the ground, and the Pakistani division, which was withdrawing from across the Meghna, then went north instead of going south, and suddenly Dhaka became an objective. I've asked General Manekshaw this. I said, "Sir, were you actually looking at Dhaka?" He said, "No." He was very frank about it. "I was very happy. We got in about 7-8 kilometers. We would have recognized Bangladesh and waited for the rest of the things to happen. But then events overtook all that, which of course will come up in subsequent discussions. The last point, sir, which I would like to touch upon as a military historian, are the two main lines which you refer to, which is the Ratcliffe line as well as the MacBourne line. Ratcliffe line was not even a political line. It was a strategic line drawn up in 1917 by a chap called Colonel Minderjahan, who was in the War Office, because that is the time when they actually set about creating Pakistan. This was put up to the House of Lords. In fact, the Division of India was worked out in 1917 after World War I. When the British said, if home rule comes, it will be followed by a demand for independence. And that time they divided India between Hindustan, Pakistan and Princistan. And they put a footnote saying, Princistan kabhi nahi hoga. But we will use it as a bargaining chip to bring the Congress into line. And the Muslim League is going to now, be offered this. And why did they do that? Because they simply wanted access to the oil fields of Iran, Bahrain and also to a certain extent Iraq. As far as the MacMahon line is concerned, again, it was a strategic line. The first expedition went in 1911, Morshid and Bailey. Morshid was a surveyor, and his survey of the watershed even today stands the test of time. And as far as Bailey was concerned, he was looking at everything else, the anthropology, how we fireplace, kitne ghode hain, kitne yaks hain, where is the tree line, how is the whole thing defined, because until then, boundaries were described by what? This is tree line, grazing area, this is India's, India, whatever the state was at that time. This is the pastures, this is for us, this is Tibetan. So all these things over a period of time have been evolving, and with technology taking rapid steps, this is becoming more and more defined and more an area of conflict.
Thank you, Kunal. Now we move forward. See, there were three major areas where this division of geography, it had a very profound impact. One was division of Punjab, second was division of Bengal. The dust has settled down there, and today we have a very friendly nation, Bangladesh, and Punjab is also an essential part of India. Now let's go to Jammu and Kashmir, where the ball game was entirely different. I don't want to go into the background of that, Though presently we have a geographical advantage in the sense that all the rivers, which are actually lifeline of Pakistan, are flowing from state of Jammu and Kashmir. But on the other side, we lost a very significant chunk of this territory, and that is your northern areas, Gilgit-Baltistan, and that has thrown up its own challenges. Very recently, we've also has been drawing and redrawing up maps, both by India and Pakistan as a countervailing, and even Chinese waking up and now suddenly after, many decades reclaiming that 1959-60 claim line, the whole LAC, this thing. So I would request Aarti Tikku to tell us how geography has and is impacting this GNK conundrum.
Thank you, General Sharma, for giving me this opportunity to speak after three intellectual giants, including yourself. Journalists are fundamentally ignorant, benighted generalists, and it is an honor to be sitting amongst you and speaking on such an important subject as we are today. I want to mention, you mentioned Robert Kaplan's history, Revenge of Geography. There was another book written by Tim Marshall. It's called Prisoners of Geography. And I think it's important to understand this phrase, Prisoners of Geography, in the context that if you look at our neighbors, whether it's Pakistan or China, they have overcome the constraints of geography in many ways. And I'm slightly taking a different position than Dr. Chopra. I, with due respect, slight difference of opinion when you said that the creators of the three lines, Radcliffe, then of course the Durant line, and the McMahon line, were unaware of the implications when they created these lines. I think they were fully aware, and I agree with Kunal that it was strategically constructed. These lines had their strategic importance for the British, and I think to a certain extent, it is the same game as the British played as an imperial power, that now the West, which is led by the US and China, which is essentially an Eastern imperialistic power, they are again in a battle of imperialistic control of the world. And therefore, we must understand how China and Pakistan overcame the constraints of geography in this region where India, at a certain level, I think, is cornered. For example, I think Lord Curzon in 1909 essay wrote tremendously about India's strategic importance because of its geopolitical location. that on one hand we had the Indian Ocean, we had access to the ocean. On the other hand, we had access through Afghanistan to Central Asia. We had Indus. We had control over rivers. We had, in fact, he even mentioned that we could have veto against any rival in Tibet. But then India has lost that strategic importance on its western front, that is Tibet, because China occupied Tibet in 1950s, early 50s. So that's where I feel that geographical continuum, notwithstanding, China has overcome geography. Today, China is in control of South China Sea, whether we like it or not. India, what is India's strategic advantage? We all know in the oceans, but have we really optimized that advantage? I'm not sure. Again, Pakistan, essentially an extension of colonial project in the region, has denied India its not only civilizational, geographical advantage, but also the geopolitical advantage in 21st century by having control over Gilgit-Baltistan, northwestern frontier province. Now, where do we go from here? As General Sharma was also pointing out, that Pakistan's lifeline is Indus. And by all accounts in history, people who lived on the Indus, people who lived east of Indus, were Hind, were people who belonged to the civilization. And people of the civilization had trade routes, as you also pointed out, with the rest of the world. It was a lifeline for India, it was a lifeline for Hindustan throughout history, and that lifeline has been denied by Pakistan. That's why I said we are prisoners of geography. We need to overcome these constraints, because the advantage that we surrendered in 1947, since we are talking about Jammu and Kashmir, and I often say that Jammu and Kashmir has both fortune and misfortune of being the center, at the center of three civilizations, and today three nuclear powers. Now, fortune, because J&K can deny Pakistan its strategic advantage. Jammu and Kashmir is the only state that can, one, stop historical invasions, also if you remember, Queen Didha perhaps was the only queen of the 11th century who left such a strong military in Jammu and Kashmir that Muhammad Ghazni failed in attacking and occupying Jammu and Kashmir. And India, I would say, unfortunately, in the last 70 years, squandered that advantage, because we, in 1947, did not push Pakistan further. We did not, in 1971, when we had massive advantage in Bangladesh because of the liberation war, we again squandered that opportunity. And then, of course, I would say, even in the last 30 years, yes, we've been fighting. In 1990, India was at its lowest because we had instability politically, we were militarily also a bit weak. Economically, we were a complete basket case in 89-90. But in the last 30 years, we have regained that position. We have regained some of the weaknesses. And I think the misfortune of Kashmir is the fact that Kashmir, which is a Muslim majority region, has never recognized, or I could say that in the last, I wouldn't say never, in fact, till 1965, Kashmiris had a good understanding of the geopolitical advantages, geopolitical location, geopolitical strategy of the region. That is why Kashmir was on the side of India, even in 1965 war. Now, what has happened after 71 actually, in J&K, is that Kashmir, the majority, I would say, somehow did not feel that the Indian state had its grip in the valley. And that's when the whole notion that India cannot really protect that region, it went deep into the psyche of the local population. And that's where we again squandered the opportunity to, one, of course, strengthen our position in J&K, but also push the line of control in J&K. I think, you know, there are a lot of things that I could go on and on, but I think my 5 minutes are up.
Thank you very much for this very sort of, I would say, a very de novo view of and the strategic geography of J&K. I think we run out of time. We have the next session, but I just want to flag two issues for a further deliberation. One is, how do we manage the strategic geography of Jammu and Kashmir state? It should not be seen purely from the political calculations, but from the larger matrix of India's strategic security. And second is, what do we do with the island territories of Andaman, Nicobar, Maldives? How do we appropriate those territories for the furtherance of India's influence in the Indo-Pacific construct? So with these words, all it remains for me is to thank the three eminent panelists, and my apologies to the audience that we run short of time for not having any question answer session. Yeah?
I'd like to flag one issue here. If we see that is recorded in the USI 150 years booklet, but we in the early 19, one officer from the British Army, he had reconnaissance and he has written an article on the strategic importance of Kashmir. He has flagged it in a way that whatever pattern of attacks to the India was there, these were through the plains of the rivers, and Kashmir was the flank. He said anything coming that time, the logistic tail was so long, if the, whosoever is holding the Kashmir will be able to cut the logistic chain, and then they cannot survive. So that is one aspect which was brought out by the, I'm talking of early 90s, I am not very sure of. This is already recorded in the USI, there's a 150.
Glad.
Yeah, the military musings.
So
yeah.
It has brought out that in more detail, people can read that.
Thank yeah. you. Thank you.
And that is relevant today, that what do we do with CPAC if China gets more emboldened? We will have our own options to derail CPAC, and we should be looking at it from that perspective. So with that, thank you very much, and we look forward to the next session.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Thank you.